last two exercises today. And what we will be looking at now today is moving objects. What we can do, or what we have in our class to do, little things like. So what I will present is the velocity selector, a disk chopper, and a Fermi chopper. Just basics on what they can do and what they can think of, the ways you can think of it. Now, one thing that has been suggested is that couldn't you simulate a chopper by simply making its position time dependent? That won't work because in my class, everything, all the positions are set when you start the simulation. So therefore, you can't have dynamic at positions. So it has to be done inside things that move and things that are act dynamically in time has to be done inside. That's why it's like this. So to start with a velocity selector. If you have a bunch of colors coming in and you basically select the neutron energy or color as in wavelength that you want, or in fact it's the same thing as velocity, and what it is really something like this. It's a set of absorbing blades that move while the neutron is passing through. So consider a neutron coming through here, and then this blue block is going to be moving downwards while the neutron is moving through it. Then if you have exactly the right speed when you enter this, you will also exit it at the same time. But if you're faster, i.e. shorter wavelength, then you will hit the preceding blade, and if you're too slow, you will hit the blade afterwards. Now, having one of these blocks move linearly is impractical. So therefore, this is the way it's actually built. So that you have this rotating drum, and you can see these slightly curved blades going along. And that means that you can select, without chopping up the beam, you can select a single wavelength from it. The resolution of these things is typically around 10%. So it's good enough for some things, and not good enough. An animation of this where you can see neutrons of every color coming along, and then just neutrons of one color exiting from it. I think this is the way one of us looks like in real life. Are you? At least in my implementation coming from ASCII. This has not come out quite yet, I can tell you. These are just some of the parameters for the requirements that you actually need. You need an aperture where the beam comes in, and then down here, these are actually specifying what the blades look like.
If you want to work, I think that might be the sort of useless problem.
Yeah.
If you want to see something like that.
So just some geometrical parameters, and well, that's very important. The most interesting one is the one that is down here, which is actually the frequency that you spin with, which is the one that actually picked the wavelength with. We will be playing with that in the exercise as we go along. To the disk chopper. This can be used for several things, generally defining the time structure of a beam. If you don't have a time structure to begin with, that would be an array of sources. You guys know a pulse source, if you have a time structure. And then you can do time of flight measurements to actually differentiate between various wavelengths. In McStas, this is what we try to simulate. A single disk with a single opening in it, angular opening, it spins with a frequency, has a radius. Now, to help you out a bit, the way it's positioned is slightly strange. It's one of those that is not positioned in the where in the center of the component. It's actually in the center of the slip opening. So if you just put the chopper such that the slit opening or the top there happens to be on your beam, then this is when you're transmitting as much as possible. You can also have an optional beam stop inside here, so you will have a double opening moving. I think you can also have several symmetrically placed openings around. If you wanted to have an asymmetric chopper where you had a single one opening of one size and another opening of a different size spinning around, you can target that with you don't have to target that with several chopper components. You can put them as close, almost as close as possible as you can think of together, because these are actually mathematical disks, in a sense. Completely absorbing disks or completely transmitting disks. Again, this has gone haywire with this format.
Time that corresponds to when the chopper is open.
Yes.
So that's it.
Yeah.
So the weight is not really, yeah. It's not actually. What's that?
Exactly. So let's say one way of, so this is essentially for the reactors, right?
Yeah.
That you define the time so that the chopper was open. Mm-hmm. So whatever wavelength came, it can actually make it through within the time frame that the chopper was open. Whereas the other way would be that you put the time already at the source, and then you randomize a long time, say between 0 and 1 second or something like that, and then you spin the chopper. And this will of course kill all the intensity that doesn't make it through. So it's a statistics optimization.
Yeah, exactly. So as to keep the number of rays that you move forward a higher number.
Yeah.
Because we want to keep statistics as far as we can go with it. You can also have several policies if you have to have this is first to be true, so that you generate more than one pulse in your chopper. Again, this is for reactors, I think. Now, the last one, so in this case, this is just an illustration of putting two choppers next to each other. They're slightly different in they're off in rotation or in delay, and there's a slight difference as to the opening start opening of them, and then just putting a screen behind them so that you can see the intensity being let through. That is also with a stop chopper.
Well, so what this actually is supposed to show, I mean, you're absolutely right, that could be this optional beam stop, if you put it there, but what it was really supposed to show is the user group to add them together. So I guess the graphics should be better. We should make one of these openings.
There are two choppers.
Yeah, it should be two choppers. Right. So it should be two choppers, and then we use a keyword. We will come back to it later, what it is exactly, but called group that allows two components to work in parallel, multiple components to work in parallel. So what happens here is that either, let's take the laser here, so if you arrive here, of course you will make it through here. This will raise a scatter, and the rest of the disk will be absorbed. But in this case, when they are in the group together, absorb means try the next one. And this means if it made it here, then it also may be made transmitted through. So it's a kind of exclusive or an XOR logic. That's what it is.
We will get back to the groups.
Yeah. I have a question. Now, how to change the rotational direction? Rotational direction, how to change it?
Change the.
The direction of rotation?
Yeah. If you make the frequency negative, that means that the chopper spins the other way.
For example, two disc,
yeah.
Double disc chopper.
Yeah.
The rotation direction is opposite.
Yes.
Opposite. How to set the direction?
So, the input parameter mu. If this is positive, that means that the chopper spins clockwise.
Negative
means counterclockwise. So if you put two choppers after each other, which have different signs on the mu, that means that they're counter-rotating. So that's a way to do that. And the last one is the Fermi chopper. It's actually a drum that rotates this way instead of the disc chopper rotates like this, right? And the Fermi chopper rotates like this and has optional channels going through in the middle where absorbing blades, it's a collimating thing, and then also absorbing chopper rolls and so on. And one of the nice things about a Fermi chopper is that the rise time of it is much can be much faster than for a disk chopper. You can imagine when these openings move in to the guy, in this case, move into to the beam opening, there will be, while they're moving in, there will be a slope to the rise, to the intensity, as the chopper goes from fully closed to fully open. The faster you spin, the faster this goes. But in this case, you have a longer tube through which the neutrons are supposed to be traveling, and that means that this can open faster than for a disk chopper. Here's a picture of a simulation where you sort of see them entering and see some of the neutrons going through and the scattering on the, or the things happening on the walls and then get through. And without further ado, I think the next step is to go on to the exercise on choppers, where we will add a chopper inside your guide.
What is the velocity selected first?
Nope. We switch order of them. So we add a chopper to get rid of the high order.